Welcome to the first Living Healthy podcast featuring Dr. Henry Domke. In this, the first of what we hope will be many visits with Henry, he talks about what it means to live healthy and his role as a physician in helping patients, and now listeners, live healthier lives. My name's Steve Mays, and I'm a friend and patient of Dr. Domke's, and I'll be helping with some of the technical stuff.
Living healthy, a lot of it gets down to preventing the need for healthcare. I mean, I always joke that one of the things I'd love to do with my patients is to make them so healthy they don't need me, make them so healthy that they don't need medicine. And so I think the concept is prevention, and that can be done by the person themselves. It doesn't have to be done by me to them, but there's some relatively simple things that you can do to be healthier.
You know, I mean, when you have somebody in your office the first time and this comes up, where do you start with that kind of concept?
Well, of course, I always hear what questions they may have and just try to get a sense of what their beliefs are. I mean, a lot of people like to take pills and they like medicine and they, you know, they want to take as many vitamin pills or other pills that they can. But, you know, I always try to get into lifestyle. You know, what do they do for physical activity? What's their diet like? You know, do they use tobacco? What's their use of alcohol or other drugs? And try to get some sense of, you know, just when I first meet them, to get a sense of where they are, and then that helps me to guide them to maybe a better place. For example, if, say, they use tobacco, and one of the things I like to do is help prioritize things, and I think that's one of the most critical things. It's so easy, you get inundated with all this information, this latest news article about some obscure illness and you're scared to death, and or some new exciting drug that you've heard an advertisement for. But the thing that you don't get with all that is to prioritize things, and to me that's critical. Because there's some very fundamental basic things, and if you put those as your first priority, you'll get better bang for your buck, so to speak. For example, if that patient I was interviewing said, I really work out and I do all this good stuff with my diet, and I smoke 2 packs a day, but, you know, I'm going to quit someday, I would probably spend the entire visit talking about tobacco. Because realistically, they're going to get more benefit out of focusing on that issue than, frankly, anything. So what I try to do is use my knowledge to help prioritize what's really going to be important for that person if they're interested to hear about it.
You know, so many of the things that you tell us about living healthy, we all kind of know. Do you see it as the role of the caregiver, the physician in your case, to try to persuade us to do the things we know anyway?
Absolutely. I mean, I do that. I think just by the fact that I would spend so much time with it maybe shows the person, the patient, that I really mean this, and therefore maybe it'll sell the idea to them. So that's part of it, that I would place that much importance on it, that I would take a chunk of time during the visit to talk about that. That might help them realize, hey, you know, there's a list of 100 things I need to do, but maybe I need to focus on these 3. So yes, part of it's a sales job.
Has it been your experience that most of us are willing to do the things that we could do to live healthy?
Well, that's difficult. It's very hard to change habits, and I understand that. And so I try to, people always come in and kind of look sheepish, like, you know, they say, well, you're going to yell at me. And I go, I'm not going to yell at you. You know, this is difficult stuff. You know, so the truth is, no. This is very, even though these things are, a lot of the concepts are known by people, they're hard to pull off. But I might have tricks to make it more likely that they'll succeed. And so I can give people guidance, you know, and kind of hear where they are and maybe give them a better chance at accomplishing it. But the truth is, this is, most people don't achieve this.
Do you sense that your approach to living healthy in your practice of medicine is different than perhaps the medical profession at large? Or would you have any way of knowing that?
Oh, I don't know. I'm probably have always been a little bit of an odd duck, you know, and I think that most of my patients know that, you know, that I probably spend, I've always had an interest in prevention, always. And, you know, going back into before medical school, even in medical school, I did a lot of research on preventive measures. You know, I did research on smoking cessation techniques. I did, ran weight loss clinics, you know, this was years ago, so I mean, it's been a long-term interest, and my patients know that, and so they've kind of self-selected where, you know, maybe those that don't want to hear that don't see me anymore. But I do hear complaints, you know, frankly, that not all physicians do this. And it's difficult in today's world where there's this time, especially if you're in primary care, as I am, I'm a family doctor, that there's this pressure to get people in and get them out and just, you know, find out what's wrong and give them the right medicine and go on to the next patient. I mean, that's kind of built into the healthcare system today, unfortunately, and I think it's tragic, and I refuse to do it. As you know, I closed my practice about 9 or 10 years ago, and I just don't want to deal with that. So, but many physicians, though, do feel this time crunch, and so that limits their ability to spend a lot of time with this. There are many other physicians that do, but probably I'm a bit of an odd duck here, and I spend a lot of time with it.
If you could get all of your patients, current or past, in a great big auditorium and talk to them for 10 or 15 minutes, what kinds of things would you say to them?
Well,
not the way you practice medicine.
I don't know.
That's a bad question.
I don't know. I mean, it's hard to say. I think what I prefer to do is individualize it, and rather than meet with an auditorium of, you know, 1,000 people, meet with one person, and I want to hear what they're interested in. I need to know where they're coming from. You know, that really helps me, because I believe in custom tailoring the advice that I give. I don't want to just give blanket recommendations, although I guess it's kind of difficult in a situation like this podcast to individualize it, but hopefully I can give people the flavor of that and let them pick and choose what they're willing to work on. But one of the things I would say is, a lot of this stuff is simple. I mean, that you know, it's pretty basic stuff. And on the other hand, because it's hard to implement and there's so many ideas out there, you need to know how to filter it. You need to know how to pick good data from bad data, and how to interpret those, you know, news reports that are coming out about the latest scare or the latest cure. And lastly, I'd say, you know, just in terms of medicine, one thing that's always impressed me about medicine is our limitations. And I think people don't talk about this very much, but there's sort of an expectation from drug advertisements and just the nightly news reports on all the advances that we really know a lot about what we're doing as physicians. And people expect us to have answers for everything. I think based on kind of this media perception that we really know what we're doing. But the truth is, you know, we don't really know very much yet. I mean, we've improved in the last couple hundred years, and especially in the last 50 years, but I'm amazed at how much we don't know. I mean, and frankly, a lot of what is done in medicine is not the science of medicine, but the art of medicine, and kind of this is just the way we do it. And given that, I think I would just say that leaves me a little bit more flexible in talking with people, you know, that realize that a lot of the things we don't have absolute hard information to say this is the way it is, and you have to be flexible.
Since this, we're using some relatively new technology here, although I guess radio is not particularly new, but podcasting is a year and a half old. You know, one of the things that I guess I would hope that if we hit a dry spell and you're not coming up with anything to talk about, I know you have interesting thoughts about technology. So I could see as we go forward with this, right now I think our thought is maybe we'll try to do this weekly, depending on your schedule. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I can think of so many topics, and this is the first show, and I didn't give you much time to prepare, but are any thoughts on things you'd like to, I mean, sort of general topic areas you'd like to deal with as we go forward week to week?
Well, you know, it's interesting talking about the impact of technology on healthcare delivery. And for me, something that I have been very interested in is communication with patients. And I am very eager about the concept of enhancing that communication through email. I think that right now there's some really difficult things on that, but I frankly think this will be a big revolution when patients can contact physicians through email. Maybe it'll be filtered through their nurses probably, but there has to be some security measures put into place. But I'm very excited about that to help patients. Maybe they don't even need to see the doctor. Maybe it can all be done through secure email. So that's one thing that I'm very interested in. And websites to disseminate information or give people a chance to log on and look at their lab data. This is something that's just starting to happen, and I think it may reduce some of the frustration that I think, frankly, most people have with their healthcare providers.
Well, I know there's, like you said, there's legal and governmental regulation kinds of things, but the Living Healthy podcast has a website because it has to have a place for people to subscribe. So, you know, depending on what your inclinations are, we'll have an opportunity to post any thoughts or links or ideas you have there.
I'd love to. I think that trying to, if just point people to good information, the web has been an incredible boom and help to people about getting information about health. And I think these days, frankly, probably the majority of my patients and probably the majority of patients in America go to the web when they have they're diagnosed with some serious illness, cancer, or they need a surgery or you know something, or if they get a medicine, my guess is they're going to do a Google search, which frankly I think is really great. I think that an educated patient is going to get better health care. They'll ask better questions and they will in the end get better care, I think. Though it's good to question who you're working with. So I would like to, but the trouble, the downside is that there's bad information out there too. Not a tremendous amount, but you know, if you get onto a wacky website, you know, you can get some very bad information. So because you got to know who you're dealing with. So maybe I could point people in some directions, at least that I think are reasonable.
You know, a little housekeeping item or two. Each week when we post the weekly Living Healthy podcast, we'll put show notes up, just brief links maybe to things that you talk about or resources that you've alluded to. By the time people hear this, we'll have the Living Healthy podcast registered at iTunes and at the new Yahoo podcast directory and any of the others. And we'll be sure to put an email link on the website, on the blog. So I suppose if it's all right with you, that if somebody said, gosh, you know, Dr. Henry, can you tell me the difference between the regular flu and the avian flu? You know, send those emails to us, and we'll gather them all up and bring them in, and then you
sure.
can talk them.
Question and answers is great. I mean, that's often the way I work with my patients, as you know. I mean, if give me a question, and I'll roll with it. And so, yeah, if people have questions, I'd love to hear what you'd like to have them talk about.
Well, you know, we're coming right up on 15 minutes here, and this is probably a good place to kind of wrap this up. The show will, folks, could be anywhere from 10 to 15 to 20 minutes long. It sort of depends on the, it'll be topic driven by things that Dr. Domke wants to talk about. This didn't hurt, did it?
It's fun. I love to talk about this, so I hope that we can continue this.
All right, and in between shows, as you have suggestions or ideas or things, we can get them on the website, and you can say, hey, coming up in a future podcast, we'll talk about this.
So. Yeah, yeah, great.
First doc on your block to be podcasting, as far as you know?
As far as I know, it feels great.
All right, from the office of Dr. Henry Domke here in beautiful Jefferson City in mid-Missouri, this is episode 1 of the Living Healthy Podcast. Thanks, bye.